thank you that you are our strength.
Yes.
Strength like no other. And so we summon that strength tonight as we prepare to proclaim the message of the year, the final message of this year.
Yes.
I pray that tonight you will speak to us.
Yes.
Cause us to be empowered.
Yes.
Enabled by your spirit to march into a new year with new fortitude and energy. Now, God, I thank you. Bless the preaching of the word. Give your servant preaching ability. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Come on and clap your hands and tell the Lord thank you. Thank you, Brother Joe, and thank you, Elder Simeon, Deacon Ron, Deacon Lynn, all of the deaconess, the Debbie Gibson, to all of you, nurses, ushers, everybody, the dancers. Thank you to the New Year's Choir, and thank you to Sister Bond for that wonderful worship melody. Let's give the Lord praise and glory. Now, I certainly don't have a long sermon tonight, and so you know what I always ask you to do, and that is talk back to me, and I'll get out of here in 25 minutes. Amen?
Amen.
I said amen.
Amen.
All right, it's cold outside, and I want to get back in my bed. So, 2 Timothy chapter 1. There is a word from the Lord. 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 6. When you have it, rest upon your feet. Say amen.
Amen.
Verse 6. This is the word of the Lord for us for the new year. For this reason, I remind you to rekindle the gift of God. You may be seated. I want to talk briefly tonight, should the Lord give us strength. I want to talk about rekindle the fire. Rekindle the fire. Would you read so kind as to repeat the words of our subject? Rekindle the fire. Sansa Ray, the older I get, there is a development of disdain for the New Year's celebration. These times used to be, were a time of great expectation and joy. To the contrary, Anita, I've grown increasingly dissatisfied with much of this holiday. There are a few reasons why that fuel this frustration, Sister Darlene. First, there are those who make empty and vain resolutions. There are those who say, within the new year, in this new year, there will be no drama in my life. In this new year, I'm going on a diet. On this new year, I'm going to spend time with my family and my pets. In this new year, I'm going to give some more money to the church. At least that's what I hope some of y'all say. Such commitments never really materialize. If that isn't disappointing enough, churches aim in perpetuating a false sense of hope. For when you go to so many churches, here's what you're going to hear. And this is what I've heard down through the years as I've been going to church for New Year's Eve. It's my time. Ain't gonna take no more in 04. Ready to fly in 05. Gonna make it to heaven in 07. Gonna make it straight in 08. Get clean in 2014, on the winning team in 2016. These are all the kind of themes that I hear throughout the year. It is not the declaration, but rather it is the reality that so much happens between January 1st and December the 31st. That once we come to the climax, once we take introspection of the year that has passed, we come to the realization that nothing has been done. That everything that we have set out to do has not, we have not had a chance to do it. We have made declaration after declaration after declaration. I'm going, this is my year. Or you go to a preacher and the preacher told you, this year is going to be your year. Yeah, and every year you come to the new year and said, that preacher done lied to me and told me this is going to be my year. Whose fault is that? Who do we blame for such inconsistency? Should the church or the individual? Can I suggest to you, brothers and sisters, that life is filled with so many experiences that sometimes you lose sight of what God has for you, that your intent and your sincerity is there. You desire a great year. You desire to make life a great life, but between the 1st and the 31st of December, you're saying, listen, I have had about enough. Anybody in here can testify that between January 1st and now, you have had some hills to climb. Can I get witness in here? Come on now, talk back to me in here. Anybody on the left side can testify that you have had some issues in this year? That ain't my style. Come on, anybody on the right side can testify you've had some tears to cry this year? You've had some issues in this year? You've been frustrated? You've been exhausted? Have you been tired of being sick and tired of being sick and tired? You've lost one thing, you lost one person, you lost this, you lost that, and it just seems as if every time you turn around, life seems to only be getting worse, and yet the preacher, we come at this time, and the preacher's going to tell me that next year is going to be my year. What do I do when I have to deal between January 1st and December 31st? What do I do when I lose my passion? What do I do when I lose zeal for life? What do I do when I lose a sense, when I don't feel like my life has any meaning? What do I do when it seems as if I got more tears than I got laughs? What do I do when it seems as if I am all out of steam? What do I do when my fire is burning low? What do I do when I am frustrated? Anybody in this point at this moment in your life can say you're frustrated. Anybody here can testify that you're frustrated, not just with life, but where you are in your life. Frustrated with my job. Frustrated with the family. Frustrated with friends. Frustrated with things. Frustrated with church. Frustrated with life. When my fire has gone low. Let's peruse the text for a few minutes and see if we can glean an answer. Amen. Paul is writing to his son Timothy. Paul is in prison in Rome. This veteran pastor is coming to the close of his earthly ministry. Death awaits this man. The situation with his protege Timothy is different. This young pastor has been placed in Ephesus to refute false doctrine and to teach how to properly conduct oneself in the church of the living God. Like Timothy had to endure all sorts of pain in just trying to be the best that he could be. Timothy had to endure problems. His pain was so great that he suffered physically from stomach trouble. That's why Paul had to say, drink a little wine for your stomach's sake and for your often infirmities. I'm not giving y'all no ideas tonight. That might just be therapeutic for some of y'all. Anyway, the first letter was instructional, while the second letter is pastoral. He begins this letter with his usual thanksgiving. He gives praise, verse number 3, to God, of whom he worships with a clear conscience at his ancestors. He says, Timothy, and the words that really surround, that govern this text is remember, reclaim, rekindle. All of these are the words that govern this text. He says, Timothy, every time I remember you, I pray for you. And you know, brothers and sisters, there is nothing like knowing that somebody is praying for you. Can I get a witness in here? Anybody here can testify that you are here today because there was some moment.